In Revelation, we read the following prophecy: "And when the 1,000 years are completed, the adversary shall be released from his prison, and shall go out to deceive the nations which are in the four corners of the earth, Gog and Magog, to gather them to battle, of which the number of them is as the sand of the sea. And they had gone up upon the breadth of the earth, and encircled the encampment of the saints and the beloved city, and fire descended from out of heaven and devoured them." For those of us who understand the identity of our people, for those of us who understand the identity of our adversaries, we know that the location of the camp of the saints is distinctly wherever the children of Israel may dwell abroad. We explored in our video, The Kingdom Among Us, that the children of Israel are the living stones of the kingdom, synonymous with Mount Zion, and the kingdom is firmly wherever they may dwell. Though the kingdom will not be consummated in its fullness until Christ sits upon the throne, knowing that the people form the foundations of the kingdom, it is for this reason that Christ said to the Pharisees that the kingdom of God is among you. The men and women listening to that conversation which Christ had, they were living stones, and even until then, many peoples had pressed themselves into this kingdom. Think Canaanites, Idumeans, and others. Judas Iscariot was one of them, an Idumean of the town of Kerioth. The statement made by Christ is clear when rendered with an honest inspection of the Greek. In this verse of Revelation, we see that the camp of the saints is facing an invasion of some sort. Now, many Judeo-Christians, they are aware of the identity of Magog and its clear biblical connections to Russia. For this reason, eyes around the world, especially among Christians, are fixed on the conflict and fervently awaiting any further development. Now, they are not wrong in their interpretation, for Magog is Russia in part. Magog, to be more specific, is a biblical land north of the Caucasus, and it includes some other Asiatic countries as well. Now, this conflict with Magog is also described explicitly and famously in Ezekiel. It's also alluded to by other prophets, such as Joel, in less explicit language, but it's all describing the same event. Prophetically, Ezekiel notes, and this is interesting, that Rosh in the Septuagint, or Rosh in the Masoretic text, is the leader or prince of Gog, Meshech, and Tubal. Now, it's interesting because Ezekiel wrote that 1,500 years before the Germanic Rus conquered the land, and it shows his divine inspiration. What is important to note about this prophecy of Gog and Magog is that this prophecy has already been fulfilled in part. Now, this may be new for your ears, but it is important to understand, so keep listening. Furthermore, this fulfillment does not neglect the possibility for a future fulfillment, such as one involving militant invasion. Christians must be aware of two things, though, in order to identify all the prophecies in Revelation properly. First, the origins of futurism and its fallibility when compared to pragmatic scriptural interpretation must be known. Secondly, the identity of the woman and also the dragon and his cronies must be understood. We will begin with these things in brief, and then we will dive right into Gog and Magog. If it's new for your ears to hear that many of Revelation's prophecies have already been fulfilled, then you have the Catholic Church to thank for that. Paranoia and power grabs, they can drive certain individuals to create fanciful theories to tickle the ears of men. Don't worry, that will happen 2,000, 3,000, 4,000, a million years from now. Don't worry about anything today. Don't worry about me. Prophecy has always been alive and active, and such was understood by our ancestors who knew that prophecies played out in real time. Is this not how Isaiah unfolded? What if Jeremiah? How about Ezekiel or Daniel? And even the minor prophets? It was even required that prophets provided immediate prophecies as a deposit towards the assurance of their more long-term and transcendental prophecies. It also confirmed that they were indeed prophets of God and not someone looking for attention. Revelation was no different, and early church fathers looked at Revelation with a strong historicist view, just as any other prophecy was analyzed, such as Isaiah, Jeremiah, etc. Howbeit, when Revelation was first received, a more futurist perspective was of course by nature necessitated, but not anymore. We have now had the prophecies of Revelation for, think of it, over 1900 years, and it is approaching complete fulfillment. After the first 1400 years of development, historical fulfillment by that time had already become clear enough for some Christians that a strong distrust and wariness was developing for the papacy. While the accusations that such Protestants made of an Antichrist element were off the mark, the clear ties of the papacy with the little horn of Daniel and the second beast of Revelation, they were right on the nose. Such things being evidently clear to anyone with historical understanding. To respond to these accusations, the papacy hired certain Jesuit priests to create a doctrine known as futurism. Essentially, they took all the prophecies being used to condemn them at the time and pushed them all to a far future and unspecified supernatural date. A time so far distant and far removed from themselves that they were perpetually immune from criticism. A mischievous and clever idea, and well, it worked. Slowly at first, but within 300 years, and especially with the popularization of the Scofield Bible, a lot of Protestants adopted this Catholic deception. The fanciful idea gave many Christians a form of what we could call prophetic amnesia. Instead of knowing the Word of God to be active, it was squished down into a preview of something which now came across as a far-fetched science fiction novel. Of course, the papacy used sophistry, but what we should do is investigate scripture pragmatically and honestly, and trust it. And what happens when we do so? Well, John received prophecies of things which were to begin quickly. And within 300 years, Rome was sacked by the Germanic tribes. The prophecies concerning Rome begin with those four famous horsemen. Yes, that is not a future event. Those four famous horsemen who each represent one of the four stages of the Roman Empire's rise and fall. The empire began with conquest against those afar with the bow. But then, the issues of justice and internal strife led to civil war within. After the conclusion of these conflicts, both internal and external, Rome then found new stability, and an era of prosperity led to, well, decadence and moneylending, one of the consequences being the inflation of food prices for the lower class. In the final stages of this empire's life, it became weak and unstable. As Daniel also foretold when he interpreted the toes of iron mired with clay, representing Enosh. Due to the sickening decay of hedonism and economic instability, the empire, when sacked by the Germanic tribes, was vulnerable. It was not able to defend itself, and it fell. Thank you. In this collapse, 144,000 Israelites were selected to be preserved out of this calamity. 144,000 genetic Israelites. How can you be a part of a tribe if it's spiritual? Genetic Israelites, who James wrote his epistles to, and whose hope Paul exclaimed he was in bonds for. Who Josephus noted as still presently alive, whose 12 tribes were living and breathing, and still are. The Danites were even excluded from this selection of 144,000, as they were wholly outside of the borders of Rome at the time of its fall. They were in Ireland and northern Germany. If you want to learn more about them, well, I have a video on the topic. So yes, there were indeed Israelites alive in Rome at the time. In fact, the Romans themselves were of the Zerah branch of Judah, an uncultivated olive tree, which had migrated away from Palestine before the Law and the Prophets. The Germanic tribes, which sacked Rome, they were themselves descendants of the Scythians and the Cimmerians, Israelites who came from the Assyrian deportations. The destinations of the Israelites, Scythians, and Cimmerians were the same locations which Yahweh lined out for them through the prophets. The people of Europe today are the genetic children of Israel, descendants of these Germanic tribes, the Scythians and the Cimmerians. And they are today the subject of these prophecies. The woman in Revelation represents the children of Israel today, just as she represented Israel in the Old Testament in places such as Hosea, Isaiah, and Jeremiah, the bride of God betrothed unto him on Mount Sinai. This is why she is later condemned for her adultery, just as she was in the Old Testament, and the 12 stars upon her head represent the 12 tribes. History repeats itself, namely because we don't learn from it. From the death of Rome, the first beast, another rises from its grievous wound, and we recognize it to be the papacy. The trumpets represent challenges facing the Germanic tribes after their defeat of Rome. Among these trials, the bottomless pit is opened, and from across the Euphrates, Islamic hordes invade Byzantium because of their idolatry, which they refused to repent of. Prophecies play out over the course of these centuries, many being tied with issues tied to the Reformation, but we must keep this brief, however. We want to focus on Gog and Magog. Despite the challenges from within, there was little adversity from outside during this time. During these 1,000 years, and yes, they are the same 1,000 years in Revelation, before the dragon crawls out of the pit, during these 1,000 years in Europe, our people followed God to the best of their ability, and when enemies invaded, we fended them off and we experienced great victories. During this time of prosperity, the dragon, which has for so long been tied to Edomites, Idumeans, and prophecy, Herod being one of them, the dragon is locked in the pit and, well, restricted to the ghettos. This is why these dragons later called this era of history the Dark Ages after they had crawled out of the pit. It was quite dark for them in those lowly corners of perverse and corrupt society. Now they're turning our entire society into one big alleyway. The woman is not a singular person, and neither is the dragon. However, with the French Revolution, this dragon experiences emancipation and crawls out of the pit one claw at a time. It's a slow process. This is the eighth beast of Revelation. Mystery Babylon is the eighth beast. The woman marries herself to this beast and adopts its humanist values, as it corrupts the people through propaganda and wrangles control over an international economy. When you join yourself to an entity, well, you adopt its values. The dragon in turn abuses the woman and attempts to flood her with a flood out of its mouth. We know that waters represent peoples and prophecy, and the dragon uses many tactics to deceive and weaken the offspring of the woman. Note the word there, offspring, a war between two seed lines which began in Genesis 3:15. It is given into our hearts to worship this beast, and that is where we are now. But to do so will only result in tragedy for us. We must learn the lesson. We have the call to depart ourselves from Babylon and to return to our original husband, and we must do it. During this war of hearts and minds, the same beast seeks to destroy the woman in many ways, such as through the amassing of the armies of Gog and Magog, and that is the subject of prophecy being fulfilled in our eyes today. Now that is one side of prophecy. That is prophecy concerning the fall of Babylon. But we want to go back to Gog and Magog, don't we, of course? Well, concerning Gog and Magog, the West has many underground and hidden enemies who corrupt it from within, and we've already noted some of them. The West also has many external, invisible enemies who gnash their teeth at it from afar, waiting for the opportune moment to strike. The Middle Eastern nations, Sudan, China, North Korea, and that is only naming a few. There are many punishments of disobedience towards our people besides just those of blindness. The blessings of obedience and the curses of disobedience are found in Deuteronomy, and they are natural and eternal laws. They are cause and effect. You reap what you sow. Even when our ancestors subconsciously and non-purposefully founded nations on Christian principles, they prospered, even if they themselves are not practicing Christians. These laws are there for a reason, and therefore when you follow them, you naturally have a healthy nation, just as when you follow the dietary laws, you naturally have a healthy body. We have not followed these once naturally accepted laws, though we have not for quite a while, because we are now riding the beast who has given us new values, progressive values, meaning progressing us far away from what was understood to be natural, godly, and healthy for thousands of years. Now we accept and even normalize homosexuality, miscegenation, usury, idolatry, and all other forms of sin. That is the tip of the iceberg, and I will not go further in this presentation. Among the curses of Deuteronomy, we find the curse which misled Christians have even been indoctrinated to somehow even celebrate, which is immigration. To be overrun with aliens is a curse of disobedience, while the removal and the diminishing of the aliens is among the blessings of obedience. Society is handed over to the beast, and that has included most so-called churches, which have been corrupted with universalist doctrine for a long time. Who do you think popularized a lot of those universalist heresies? The outside forces who introduced these heresies and the popularization of them has resulted in so-called churches basing their foundational beliefs on concepts that are not found in the Bible. Apostolic Christianity died very long ago. Concepts such as spiritual Israel, which means spiritual sperm, and ritual-based salvation. If we were not now asleep, how could there be a prophesied awakening? If we were not now asleep, how could our minds and hearts be handed over to the beast? The age of the fishers is long over, and we are now in the age of the hunters, as Jacob digs through the rocks to uncover and realize who he is. The reason that our learned men are prophesied to learn scripture once the kingdom is established is because they don't understand it now. They wait for some future so-called singular antichrist figure while ignoring the millions of antichrists around them every day. A passage universalists love to take out of context is Isaiah 56. Now, this is especially ironic because the passage itself prophesizes that it would indeed someday be taken out of context. Yahweh does have a sense of humor. In the passage of Isaiah 56 that they exploit, Yahweh God is addressing the Israelites who were cast off in deportations. Verse 8 in the AV reads, "Yahweh God, which gathers the outcasts of Israel, saith, Yet will I gather to him, besides those that are gathered unto him." And note that the word others was added to the text and cannot infer anything except other Israelites. The outcasts of Israel here are the strangers of Isaiah 56:3 and 6, who were alienated, cast off, and estranged from God in their deportations. Their seed being cut off made them eunuchs, and such is evident in Ezekiel, but even Isaiah 49:20-21. They had the Sabbath, they had the laws, and they're returning to their people. Universalists cannot read the Bible in context because it refutes them every single time. These outcasts of Israel had his Sabbath, they had his laws, and they had his covenant. And only Israel ever had and ever will have these things. Misinformed Universalist pastors nevertheless exploit the passage, despite the fact that the new covenant was made only with the houses of Israel and Judah. This is stated explicitly at Jeremiah 31:31-33, which Paul then repeats at Romans 9:4 and at Hebrews 8:8-13. It is in no way coincidental that once this passage ends, it seemingly abruptly speaks of ignorant teachers bringing aliens into their assemblies. It's not abrupt. Being God, Yahweh knew that Universalists would go back and take the preceding passage out of context one day, and he has a message for them, and he says, "All ye beasts of the field, come to devour. Yea, all ye beasts in the forest, his watchmen are blind. They are all ignorant. They are all dumb dogs. They cannot bark, sleeping, lying down, loving the slumber. Yea, they are greedy dogs, which can never have enough, and they are shepherds that cannot understand. They all look to their own way, everyone for his gain, from his quarter. Come ye, say they, I will fetch wine, and we will fill ourselves with strong drink, and tomorrow shall be as this day, and much more abundant." And we see all this happening today. as pastors pushed the armies of Gog and Magog out from the streets and into their assemblies. Immigration is a Deuteronomical curse. Christ came only for the lost sheep of the house of Israel, and Paul and the other apostles went only to those sheep, descendants of the Scythian and Cimmerian migrations, the Dorians and Adanans and the Zara-Judah-Romans as well. When pastors attempt to bring others besides these groups into the sheepfold, they are greedy dogs which can never have enough and shepherds that cannot understand. The harvest is great, but the laborers are few. Anyone who gathers the goats scatters the sheep. Immigration is a curse in Deuteronomy, and an effective weapon of the dragon in Revelation. The weapon of Gog and Magog is an importantly powerful one. It's the best way to bring down a civilization, to corrupt it within. But it's in no way novel. Immigration has always been a primary culprit for the fall of great civilizations in the past. The Egyptians deteriorated and collapsed when they were overrun by Nubians. Abraham was chosen out of Arphaxad, but the other Genesis 10 Adamic nations have been given up. They are no longer Adamic today. These nations were destroyed long ago and overrun by aliens, and the replacement of the previous people with a strange seed is viewed as an end. So, in Isaiah 43:3, Yahweh God said, "For I am Yahweh thy God, the Holy One of Israel, thy Savior. I gave Egypt for thy ransom, Ethiopia and Sheba for thee." And in Jeremiah 46:28, Judah and Israel are given a promise. "Fear thou not, O Jacob my servant, saith Yahweh, for I am with thee. For I will make a full end of all the nations whither I have driven thee, but I will not make a full end of you. But correct thee in measure, yet I will not leave thee wholly unpunished." The end of nations are seen in places such as Zechariah 9 as well, where a bastard dwells in Ashdod, marking an end to the Philistines. A full end will not be made of Israel, however, and that is a promise. Christ said that the cities of Israel will not be exhausted until the Son of Man comes. But it's not like the adversaries won't try. For this reason, Christ said also, "The law and the prophets were until Johannes. From then, the kingdom of Yahweh is proclaimed, and all force their way into it." They must try to force their way in, for there is no invitation or justification for them to be there. Our people, from the earliest time, were commanded to be a holy and a separate people, and we still are today, as Peter wrote to the children scattered abroad. "But ye are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a peculiar people, which in time past were not a people, but are now the people of Yahweh, which had not obtained mercy, but now have obtained mercy." Peter wrote these words to the lost sheep of the house of Israel, primarily to Greek and Germanic Israelites. 1 Peter 2:9 is an intended reference to Exodus chapter 19, verses 5-6. And 1 Peter 2:10 is a reference to Hosea chapter 1, verses 9-11, when the Israelites were cast off and divorced. Both of these are only concerning Israel. The word holy means something set apart for God, as it were exclusively His. But many times we failed in this regard, extending our altruism to those who are not like us and failing at our commandment to be a separate people. There were other nations, Adamic nations, which the children of Israel were allowed to intermarry with under certain circumstances. And there were others who Israel was not to interact with under any circumstances. Eligibility for conversion depends on origin, as origin and destiny are intrinsically tied. We are to remain apart, for when these people were allowed to reside in our nations, there was a constant corruption of the people's values as a result of it. Feeding off the prosperity of Israel, they are often referred to as cankerworms and locusts throughout prophecy. In Joel, the alien migrants are identified explicitly as such, in reference to the great army which Yahweh sent among the houses of Judah and Israel, ostensibly as a form of testing and chastisement. The Muslim hordes in Revelation are described with the same language, describing the Islamic invasions from the east of Byzantium. In Isaiah, we are told that in the kingdom, following the second advent, we will plant vineyards, and at this time will no alien any longer take the fruit thereof. What do cankerworms and locusts do? They consume. Eligibility for conversion depends on origin. Origin and destiny are intrinsically tied. We are not to cast our pearls to dogs. If one became a sheep through belief, that cannot be true, as the Canaanite woman was still a dog, even though she supposedly believed and she never became a sheep. Goats are still goats, even though they profess good works and they profess belief, but Christ doesn't know them. He doesn't know them, for as he said in Amos, he knows only one family tree. In the Bible, trees represent seed lines and people, just as in English today we have family trees, and there is only one tree once the kingdom of God is established, and that is the tree of life bearing 12 fruits, because there's 12 tribes and there's 12 gates, and if you want to enter in through those gates, you must bear the name of one of the 12 tribes of Israel. To heal our land, we must turn our faces to God and repent. This is important. But to repent, we must also understand iniquity and what is sin. Paul, speaking of Yahweh's promises in 2 Corinthians chapter 6, he repeats, "I will dwell among them, and I will walk about, and I will be their God, and they will be my people. On which account, come out from the midst of them and be separated, says the Prince, and do not be joined to the impure, and I will admit you." We can remember that our bodies are vessels for the Spirit within us, and that in Isaiah, those who bear the vessels of God are told not to touch the unclean. That is what it says in the Hebrew, and thing is added to the text, but it is not original, it's speaking of people. When we refuse to gather sheep, we gather goats, and we make ourselves nothing but scatterers. To even partake in trade with such people often led to moral and racial decay. Many times our ancestors chose to enslave such people as well, instead of drive them out, such as the Jebusites in the city of David. It was a constant problem during the days of Ezra and Nehemiah as well, and even though at that time the men had cast off their strange wives and strange children, the solution did not last. By the time of Christ, because of the actions of men, such as John Hyrcanus, many inhabitants of Judea were Edomites, including many of the Pharisees and all of the Sadducees. It was prophesied that the Messiah would be killed by the power of the dog, and this is exactly what that meant. We explained at length the nature of these two parties in our latest video titled, "The Harvest of Whom? Who is Taken and Who is Left Behind?" A part of our series on the so-called rapture. Aliens being introduced into our nations has always resulted in decay, from the very beginning, when Eve ate the fruit of another family tree, and even until now. The morality of Israel deteriorated as soon as they began mingling with those of another kind. It is for this reason that Christ described the end times as being like the time of Noah, when the daughters of Adam were miscegenating themselves with another kind. That kind being the progenitors of many of the Canaanites, as seen in Genesis 15, and they are still among us today. Then, in Jeremiah, we learn that in the times of the end, leading up to the consummation of the new covenant, which is the marriage supper of the Lamb, the house of Israel and the house of Judah will be sowed with man and with beast. The house of Israel and Judah are sowed with man and beast at this time, just as Christ said that it will be like this in the time of Noah. And those who bite the sour grape will be ashamed of their works. The beast often attempts to teach that multiculturalism is good, even though it's pragmatically condemned and our scriptures, and even though it always led to the decay and the eventual collapse of civilizations. It has always led to the fall of civilizations, as we saw with Egypt and Ethiopia, but even with Rome, as it was the seed of man being sowed with the seed of Enosh that made the toes of that great empire fragile and weak, just as Daniel prophesied. It's the same thing as the seed of man being sowed with the seed of beast. The prophecies of Gog and Magog, they describe immigration, as this is a form of invasion and warfare as much as any other. As Yahweh said, it is certainly enough to make a full end of civilizations. And we are experiencing that very thing right now as the values and the stability of the West continues to crumble. It is the dragon attempting to drown the woman with the flood out of its mouth. The dragon has used these people in attempts to destroy Israel from the very beginning as much as it is now. We see this in Revelation through the flood which came from the serpent's mouth, water representing peoples, and much of that flood coming from Magog. Remember, in biblical prophecy, immigration and militant invasion are often synonymous with one another, and it is the very way in which some nations fall. Think of Ethiopia and Joel. Whoever Magog was in the time of Genesis 10 is not indicative of who Magog is now. Peoples move, nations fall, and aliens swarm in and change the genetic makeup of original inhabitants. Magog today consists of a wide array of inhabitants, of Mongols, Khazars, Chinese, and others found among the steppes of Asiatic Russia today, all included in the flooding of Gog and Magog into Christendom. We have been invaded by Gog and Magog for longer than you know it. We are still to be separate. The heirs of the promise remain only for the lost sheep of the house of Israel, a people who never were and never will be Jews. And who is this Gog who devises and leads these devious machinations? Well, that is where you would find them. Christians should understand that the European nations, formerly known as Christendom, are indeed the camp of the saints referred to in Revelation. The constant enemy of our people are the same today as they were 2,000 years ago, a people who are in perpetual enmity against the seed of the woman. Christians should understand that these people are collectively Satan, a Hebrew word that means adversary, since they have always been in opposition to Christ. The bride is not one individual, and neither is Satan. These are two groups. It is the dragon who leads the nations against the children of Israel, who is the same as the Gog who leads Magog. Gog represents the same puppet masters of this world mercantile system we know today as Mystery Babylon. Gog, the dragon, it is the Leviathan which controls the sea. The same people who Paul said, who both killed the Lord Jesus and the prophets, and have persecuted us, and they please not God, and are contrary to all men. Who Yahweh God said he has indignation against forever, a people who themselves declared the blood of Christ to be upon them and their children forever. Wherever you find any advocates for immigration, you find them. Where you find advocates for the inhumane beast values of liberty, equality, and fraternity, you find them as well. Christians do not have full liberty, for we are all servants of Christ and of one another. There is no equality in the eyes of God, for his promises are exclusive, and each of those heirs are rewarded according to their works. There is no fraternity with the enemies of God. Despite their control over the sea, the Leviathan will be pierced, and the sea will be no more. I do believe that the prophecy of the camp of the saints has already been fulfilled, and that much is evident. I do not exclude the possibility that this may end up having a militant side as well, and I find the timing of all these events very intriguing. Just as we are now seeing the birth pains of pharmaceutical distress on the economy, we then coincidentally see this immediately after. Prophecy continues to be an active and alive force that shows us every day that God is true. the prophecy of Gog and Magog may have dual fulfillment, we should remain alert. There would be no better way to invade than through the help of Russia, as prophesized. There would be no better time to invade than when the West is weak due to an economic collapse. It is possible that the fall of Babylon and a militant invasion of Gog and Magog may happen simultaneously, or at least one after the other. It would only be natural for such adversaries to attack while the woman is wounded and weak. Remember that this is conjecture, and we will not know until the day comes, but it is something to think about. What we do know is that in both Ezekiel and Revelation, we see that this great invasion, no matter how big, is cut short when God intervenes with fire. We know that the second advent and the harvest in general will be a day of fire. I spoke about this in my previous video. So perhaps when our people are most vulnerable, perhaps when the economy is collapsed, when our luxuries are gone, and when the armies of our adversaries swoop down on our crumbled nations, perhaps then the clouds will break and our prince will come and avenge us. We will be given our call to arise and thresh, and the harvest will begin. These nations are running straight to the winepress, and our adversaries in their pursuit of total power are doing nothing but digging their graves. Once this is all over, the sea will be no more, as the sea represents this mass of people in prophecy. Just as Ezekiel says, it will take 7 months to bury the bodies, which may be a prophetic period of over 200 years. They can take away everything. They can try whatever they may try, but they cannot snatch us away from our Father's hand, and our internal life is unconditional. We will rebuild. It may take 7 months, or it may take 200 years. We will plant vineyards, and they won't supplant them. Our prince will tabernacle among us, and we will be his people, and he will be our God. Israel will be a holy and separate people. Every plant not planted by God is uprooted. Are you interested in hearing this message that the modern-day European peoples are descendants of Israelites in fulfillment of pragmatic biblical prophecy? You should be. Are you interested that biblical prophecy is now being fulfilled in front of your very eyes? You should be. Are you wondering why you've never heard this message until now? You should be. We live in an age of deception, the time of Jacob's trouble, and Jacob is collectively asleep. But you don't have to be, and you can help your brethren wake up. These past 2 years, they have been unsettling, but Jacob is starting to wake up. Will you open your eyes too? Before the day of the Lord, there is a ministry that turns the hearts of the sons back to the fathers. Israel will remember who they are. This message you are hearing is a part of that collective ministry. Visit these websites and learn more about who you are. Thank you. Yahweh bless.